Good morning. We are here together this morning to memorialize Mike Andrew Richline. And we're going to begin our proceedings this morning with military honors. So we're going to pray. I'll announce military honors. They'll come forward. And then when Taps is played, we just invite everyone, if you would, to please stand. All right, let's go before the Lord. Father God, we thank you for this time we can gather. Lord, we pray your spirit would be with us. Lord, that you would anoint this place and this time with your presence. God, that you would bring your comfort, your peace. Lord, we pray that you would just pour out your spirit in this place. We give you thanks. And we look to you now as we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, at this time we'll have military honors.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you again that we can gather. And we ask, Lord, as we continue to move forward this morning, that you, by your Spirit, would bring comfort. We pray that the scriptures shared would shine light. We pray that the songs that are sung would bring hope. And we pray, Lord, you be glorified in this place. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we have some music for you.
Your home.
Long time ago, a young Hebrew boy, probably in his early teens, spent a lot of time with the family herds. He was a little bit, he was the problem child, I suppose. If he was in the mix, something would always go wrong, so it was easier to keep him with the sheep. And one day, a prophet came to visit, and as he gathered together with the family, he was looking for the next king of Israel. And he went through all the children of Jesse, and as each one passed before the prophet said, "This is not the one." "Nope, this is not the one either." Well, the oldest son, when he came by, he looked good. He had it together, was a strapping young man, and the prophet thought, "This is the guy." But the Lord said, "No, the Lord doesn't judge from the outside. He judges the heart." So the prophet asked the father, Jesse, "You don't have any other kids? This is all of them?" He said, "Well, the problem child's out with the sheep." So Samuel said, "Well, bring him here." So David came, stood before the prophet, and the Lord said, "That's the one. His heart is not better than anyone else's heart, but he's loyal to me." So the Bible says he's a man after God's own heart. He wrote this psalm. We just heard a song version of it. During that time, we still read it all these thousands of years later. Psalm 23 starts with this phrase, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want." He means I don't need anything else. The Lord is everything I need. "He makes me lie down in green pastures," indicates the reality that we don't always know when we need a rest. Nor do sheep. That's why they have a shepherd. So he makes them lie down in green pastures. And in order for them to find refreshment, drink, the sheep need still waters. So he said, "The Lord leads me beside the still waters. I'm able to find my refreshment here." And then the thing that we're all looking for, "He restores my soul." Do you ever feel like you just have this heaviness in your spirit? You're not happy, you feel a little depressed, a little down. Well, in the scriptures, when they talk about that, they would talk about needing the restoration of your soul. Your soul gets tired, heavy, weighted down by the cares of this world. And so the promise here is that it's the Lord that restores our soul. He leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And then you have the famous phrase, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death," there is a promise in that phrase. We will all walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We're going to experience it or be close to it at one time or another in our life. And at this point, David, the psalmist, he lifts his eyes to heaven and his writing becomes personal. Instead of talking about God in the third person, he speaks of him in the first person. "You," he says, "you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me." And both of those are symbols of guidance and discipline. And just knowing that God is there guiding him through that place, the valley of the shadow of death, brought him comfort and restored his soul. "You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies." Now, sometimes we think about that as though the enemies are other armies or other people or other things, but the Bible would indicate that the enemy is death. "And you prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies." It is the Lord, we'll see in just a moment, who is the resurrection and the life, and the one that brings our sustenance even in those moments. "You prepare a table. You anoint my head with oil. You are pouring out your Holy Spirit." And in David's case, when he was this teenage boy, doesn't even know really anything but sheep, there's a prophet dumping a bucket of oil on his head. They didn't do it like we do in church now, you know, where we put a little oil on you. They poured a horn of oil on your head. So it ran, it covered you. It went everywhere. And the point was, the presence of God's Spirit is with you everywhere. You can't just wipe it off. Oil sticks to you, right? Once it's in your hair's oily. You guys know. And so he's saying, you anoint my head with oil. My cup, the picture of his needs, the things we need and how we go through life. He says, my cup overflows, and surely goodness and mercy will follow me. And the point is, as we go through life, our goal as we walk with Christ is that goodness and mercy we leave in our wake. That when we pass by, someone says, look, goodness and mercy. Goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's his promise. Now, when Jesus was here, he had a friend named Lazarus. Maybe some of you guys are familiar with him. And he died. Jesus heard news that Lazarus was sick and waited. He waited until he died, and he waited until he was dead 4 days. And then Jesus came to the family. And as he was coming to the family, Martha and Mary were Lazarus's sisters. She came to the Lord and she said, Lord, if you'd have been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus is trying to teach her something important. And that important thing is this: if you are in Christ, you don't die. You move. Your address changes. But death has no power anymore, because the Lord of life is our Lord and Savior. She said to him, even now I know whatever you ask from God, he will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. She didn't know what he meant. So she said, I know, in the last days, at the end of time, my brother will rise again at the resurrection. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. I am the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me, they'll never die. Do you believe this? And she looked at him and said, yes, Lord, I believe you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into this world. Jesus came to be the fulfillment of what David talked about all those years ago in the Psalms. He is our way, the route through which we will come before the Father. He is our resurrection. He is our hope. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Right now, let's talk about Mike Andrew Ridgeline. I have to go slow, because that's not how I want to say his last name. I've heard people have butchered that name for a long time, and I don't want to be one of those people. Mike Andrew Ridgeline was born November 22, 1964, in Coos Bay, Oregon, to Robert and Charlene Ridgeline. He grew up in Coos Bay and graduated in 1984 from Marshfield High School in Coos Bay. Growing up, he enjoyed playing high school football, hanging out with his friends. He enlisted in the United States Air Force in February 1986. He served as a refrigeration and air conditioning mechanic in the Civil Engineering Squadron at Nellis Air Force Base, Las Vegas, Nevada, for 9 years. He was also on the Prime Beef and Readiness Challenge team for Nellis. He was deployed in Operation Desert Storm from August 1990 to July 1991. While serving at Nellis, he met and married Shanna Dietrich on August 19, 1989. In 1995, he became a recruiter for the Air Force and transferred to Eugene, Oregon. He completed his military service in Eugene after 13 years in January of 1998. While in Eugene, he and his wife were blessed with their daughter Audrey on February 7th, 1995, and their son Michael on October 11th, 1996. He lived with his family briefly in Coos Bay and relocated with his family to Filer, Idaho in October of 1998. While in Idaho, he worked in various fields, including air conditioning, heating, service, medical supply, home oxygen delivery, but he found his niche when he became the pit boss working for Cactus Pete's in Jackpot, Nevada. Mike and Shanna divorced in March of 2016. Mike and his partner of 7 years, Alejandra Vicente, moved and worked in several locations before settling in West Wendover, Nevada. Mike enjoyed fishing, hunting, and camping. He also liked hiking, barbecuing, and watching football on TV. He was a lifelong Rams fan, so he understood disappointment. I can say that because I also have been a Rams fan. No matter how good or how bad they were doing or what city they were in, his other hobbies included J.R.R. Tolkien and World War II history. He was very proud of his military service. Mike passed away on April 24, 2023 at Salt Lake University Hospital after a long battle with alcohol addiction. He was preceded in death by his mother, Charlene Richline, and his son, Michael Lorraine Richline. He is survived by his daughter, Audrey Gonzalez, son-in-law, Slade Gonzalez, grandchildren, Michael, Michelle Lamont, Lila Gonzalez, father, Robert Richline, brother, Scott Richline, his sister, Vicki Richline, and many nieces and nephews. You can shed tears that he is gone, or you can smile because he has lived. You can close your eyes and pray that he'll come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that he's left. Your heart can be empty because you can't see him, or you can be full of love, the love that you shared. You can turn your back on yesterday, or you can be happy tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember him only that he is gone, or you can cherish his memory and let it live on. You can cry, close your mind, be empty, and turn your back, or you can do what he'd want. Smile, open your eyes, love, and go on. This time we have another song.
Thank you.
The Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught us beatitudes, attitudes that we ought to be. He taught us that believers ought to be salt and light. He shared with us that he came to fulfill the law and as such make a way for us that we can draw near to God. He redefined the law so that others could see and we could see that which separates us from God. He told us anger is like murder. He told us that lust is and the problems with divorce and the issues with making oaths and promises that you don't keep and the idea of retaliation and that our heart ought really to be about loving our enemies, giving to those who have a need, pray to the Father, to fast without hypocrisy, to lay up our treasures in heaven, to not be anxious but learn to trust God, to look inward at yourself before you look outward at others, that you can ask the Lord for the Holy Spirit and he'll give him to you. He said that we should do good to others. And he told us that good fruit is produced by a good tree. And then he told us none of us is good apart from him. He laid out for us that verbal assent, saying magic words, doesn't save us. And then at the end of that whole long section, he told a parable. He said, "Everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it was built upon the rock." Verse 26 of Matthew 7, he goes on, "Everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. And the rain fell and the floods came. The winds blew and beat against that house. And it fell. And great was the fall of it." Scripture lays out for us that in life, there are two paths that you can walk. In the Proverbs, he talks about the path of the wise and the path of the fool. He says, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God, but the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom." In the Proverbs, he also told us there is a path of life and a path of death. That Lady Wisdom would lead you in the way of life, and that the seductress, the harlot, would lead you in the path of death. One representing drawing near to the Lord as a source of our wisdom, and the other representing self and doing what pleases or satisfies self. Jesus, as he finishes what most people call the greatest teachings ever delivered in the Sermon on the Mount, issues a challenge. You're going to build your house on one of these things. You will either build your house on the rock, 1 Corinthians 10 declares Jesus is the rock, or you'll build your house upon the sand. Scripture also declares that the storm comes to both. So building your house on the rock doesn't mean no storms. Doesn't mean everything will be good and easy and there won't be struggles or difficulties in life. It just means your house is built on the rock. And as the storms come and the winds blow, one is able to stand and one is not. The Bible teaches us that there is a reckoning, a day of reckoning for all men, right? There will be a time where it will be shown to us we're built on the rock or we're not. To be built on the rock is to build your life on Jesus Christ. To be built on the sand is to build your life on anything else, and it will crumble. And as we gather at times like this, we come together and we want to hold on to our memories and our thoughts, but we also want to remind ourselves. There's a reason we do this. We want to remind ourselves of the choices we've made and are making, the direction our life is taking. The Bible tells us, teach us to number our days. Why? So we can be sad? No. So we make good choices. So we make good decisions in life. To remind us of our mortality. Because as Jesus declared in John 11, right? Look, he's a resurrection and the life. The Bible teaches us one day we close our eyes here and we open our eyes before him. And the scripture would want us, Jesus would want us to understand there is a way to be prepared for that meeting. Not by doing a host of good things, but by recognizing our need for the Lord. He's our shepherd. By recognizing our need for a Savior, Jesus Christ. For he is the one who makes us good trees that can produce good fruit. Because he kept the law, he's able to restore our relationship to the Lord God Almighty. And it is our prayer this morning that you are aware of all of those things. We're going to, in a few moments, we're going to leave from here and we're going to celebrate our relationship with one another. We're going to celebrate our memories of Mike. We're going to celebrate our stories. And I hope we'll take those opportunities to share them as we do, as we share a meal together, as we laugh, as we hear the joys of children playing. That's life, right? And those are the things that we want to make sure to celebrate and be aware and know that we have, or we are, in right standing before the Lord. It's pretty easy. Romans 10, 9 and 10 tells us, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, and you are his. And he has washed you whiter than snow. And you can say, I am building my house on the rock. And you can expect that there will be a great gathering one day together in our home in heaven with our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We have an opportunity this morning for one more song.
to keep you from stumbling. To him who is able to make you blameless.
That song's a beautiful picture of our benediction this morning as we go right next door for the reception. The promise that the Lord gives us for those who are in Christ Jesus is, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, to present you blameless before the presence of his glory, in his great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now, and forevermore. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we just come before you this morning, Lord. We pray, God, your hand to be on us, Lord. We pray your blessing on the meal that we'll share. We pray your blessing on the fellowship that will take place, Lord. We ask, God, that during that time, stories would be shared and hearts would be lightened, and, Lord, that you would bring your comfort and your anointing by your Spirit. We pray your blessing again on the meal and on the rest of this day as family stays together. And, Lord, we pray that you would be glorified and magnified in it all. We thank you now. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. That concludes this part of the service this morning. As you guys exit, if you go straight across the hall here on your right, that's the kitchen, and the room right on the other side of that is the reception area. Tables are set up, and it's all ready for you all to have a time of fellowship together. God bless you, and go in peace.